okay, and working on his development skills. First, there were the first 3 weeks with his pre-work before joining the bootcamp, where these 3 weeks are most about, we just want to have all our alumni the same basis. So when they finish the pre-work, they start the real 6 weeks of Ironhack, okay? During these 6 weeks, they see Ruby on Rails, JavaScript, Node.js, HTML, CSS. They learn clean code, TDD, and then they finish with their personal project. And that's why we are here, okay? Today, what we're gonna see are the best 5 final projects. Why are the best 5 final projects? This morning, a great jury came to Ironhack. They came from companies such as CartoDB. Javi Santana, the CTO, was one of the judges. Also, they came from Recreativos Franco. Maybe all of you have seen a slot machine of Recreativos Franco in a Spanish bar. They want to start like a big project on the internet, and they want to count with these guys to make it. Hope so. One of the other ones that came was the lead JavaScript developer from Tecnilogica. Also came the CEO of CBI Consulting, and finally the CTO of Novelty, a startup that just began, well, running 4 months ago. So these judges delivered the best 5 final projects, and that's why we are today here. So how is gonna be the structure today? First, we're gonna have our founder, Gonzalo, who's sitting over there, who is gonna make an introduction about Ironhack, the purpose of doing, of why he decided to found this company, and why he wants to change the way that we educate people. Then you're gonna see all the final projects, the best ones. After each presentation, you can make any question. It's important to say that these projects are technical projects. They don't have like a startup meaning, okay? These guys, maybe yeah, but was not the purpose. They don't want to start like a business with the project he made. So please, if you ask any question, keep on asking technical ones, okay? And after when we finished, we got some mojitos, 3 mojitos, sponsored by Ron Ritual, I would like to say, and I would like to thanks. So, well, let's start. And let's give a great welcome to our founder, Gonzalo.
Hi. Good evening, everyone. Thanks a lot for coming and joining us today. So I'd like to start by talking a little bit about our journey here when we started Ironhack and what have we got, the main milestones until today. So we started we founded it actually in August 2013. Soon after that, the first 12 crazy guys decided to join Ironhack, and we started the first cohort that finished around the summer, Christmas of 2013. We soon expanded to Barcelona. We started to get a lot of emails from people over there wanting also to learn to code. So we said, okay, let's do it. And that was in the summer of 2014. Then we got, my co-founder is actually from the States. So the plan was always to start in Spain and then expand to the United States. And what a better place to go than Miami. So we said, okay, let's give it a go. We got licensed. There was a lot of paperwork in order to start a school in Miami. So we got licensed in January and started the first program there. No, sorry, licensed before and started in January of this year. And finally, we're expanded kind of offers, and now we're offering also part-time bootcamps. To give you a sense a little bit of how we are growing, the first year, full year 2014, we graduated over 70 students. This year, we're gonna do 200 approximately. So we're really happy, and we're maintaining really high quality of students, and always trying to enhance the community. And we see here not only students, but a bunch of Ironhackers and alumni. So we're really glad, and mentors and teachers, that our community keeps on growing. That's part of our main purpose. So now I wanted to talk a little bit of how and why we started Ironhack. So there's something that is super obvious, is that software and even hardware are eating the world. This is a very famous statement, but I can only agree with this. So you have company like Square here in the photo, like Uber, like Airbnb, we all know them, that are taking transactions that used to be done in a traditional way or by means of mechanical ways, and taking it happening through software platforms. What does this mean? That the need for developers, it's skyrocketing. And at the same time, here in Spain, graduates of computer science have been dropping steadily since the year 2000. At the same time, you have reports from the European Union talking about nearly a million opening jobs and unfulfilled vacancies throughout Europe, right? So this just didn't make sense, having really high unemployment in Southern Europe, these vacancies, and these kind of companies really taking over the world nearly. So this was something that really got us thinking. Not only that, but coding is now not only for people that want to become coders. It's also for kids. We've gone to many schools, many universities, and you're seeing people that are not whose goal is not to become a developer, but they really like what's behind games, what's behind the software that they play around with. And they are starting to, there's programs such as Codecademy, code.org, that are introducing so many people to coding that it's just amazing, this trend. Also, you got many different jobs that are not really coding, but are in touch with developers and are touched by technology, and careers that can be really enhanced and pushed forward thanks to coding, such as UX, marketing, project management. I can think of many, no? So you have these two, let's say, big trends, the technical skill gaps, and you have this coding becoming kind of mainstream. But what's happening, despite all of this transformation, like universities are not changing, and in general, not only universities, but let's say educational models. So you have a big gap that it's ever widening between universities and the job market, and between what it's taught and how technology it's evolving, right? I'm not saying, of course, that I'm not going or advising anyone to quit university, but to not go. But I think it's they also do a great job, but they are not preparing people to get into the job market, and that is something that we have noticed. And we have a big percentage of our students are recent grads of computer science, telecommunication engineering, or industrial engineering, that have touched coding somehow, or let's say computer science knowledge, but they didn't learn, let's say, the skills that you actually need to start working at a startup. So part also of our mission is to trying to put in contact startups with students, right? With people that know how to code or that are interested in coding. it amazes me here, in particular in Spain, how computer science students, telecom students, and in general, and in particular, and the rest, only think about a career in big banking firms or consultancy companies, right? Just they don't really do research. They don't really try to find out what really motivates them, right? And on the other hand, you have the startups that don't have the resources nor the time to go to every university and trying to get you need to sign a kind of contract with each university. You need to go to hiring days. You are competing with booths of McKinsey and whatever bank it's at the other side of you. So it's hard for startups also to attract talent. So it's part of our mission to act as a bridge between startups that are really growing and doing cool things and students. In terms of education, I'd say our model is based on three main pillars. So the firstly, the instructors are not traditional students like here. Communication is not unidirectional anymore, or so we think that it shouldn't be. And educators are more as mentors. Each iteration we do of the curriculum, it's headed in that direction. In having instructors that guide your learning, so it can be self-paced as well in a certain manner, and not having just this person on top of how do you call this in English? Just speaking to an audience and not receiving any kind of feedback or any kind of interaction, right? And then an adaptive curriculum. So it doesn't make sense either for me that there's only one teacher that's responsible for a curriculum. Let's say to say what you need to learn in a subject, right? It should be what we're doing instead. It's have our team here in Madrid, people in Barcelona and in Miami, and all the pool of instructors and collaborators iterating and putting their inputs and thoughts and developing our curriculum. So it's something that is not only developed by one person or thought by one professional, but it where we're investing a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of we're receiving many inputs from many different people. No? So I think it really makes sense that curriculums are adaptive, that they are iterative, and that they take into account what many experts say, right? And then I think in terms of methodology for ads, it's really we found that it's really important, and we try to enhance the blended methodology. This means having part online and part in person. Right now, the only part that we have online is the pre-work, and we're trying to, and the engagement hasn't been great for most parts, but something that we've seen that it works, and we are working to make it better. We're also working on making part of the core curriculum not so much where you don't need to be there in person, but you can do parts from home on remote, and trying to bring what works in class to a remote or online setting. So I'd say these are three very important pillars. I think education is heading this way, and we hope to be leading it. So and I wanted to tell you a little bit now, just so you have more of a background of what kind of students come to Ironhack. These are three kind of stereotypes. So first one is the entrepreneur, Tavi Vicuña. He came on the second edition to Ironhack. He was one of the founders of Job and Talent. I don't know, can you raise your hand who knows Job and Talent? This is good. Okay, we are in Google Campus, so this is expected. So he was one of the founders. He left the company pretty early. Then he found a couple more. He went to Stanford to get his MBA, and then now he found ePolitik, which is a really cool platform. It's kind of an NGO. Its purpose is to have all the CVs of politicians open, where you can see and with red flags of who's been in a trial, who hasn't studied anything, and it's really interesting. And he's founded a couple more startups. One more, his main project is another one now, but anyway. Then Ricard Soler, which is basically self-taught. He started to study computer science in Politecnica Catalunya. He quit, he didn't really like it. He started coding on his own, then came to Ironhack, and now he works at Ching, which is like the LinkedIn in Germany. It's the number one job searching job platform. And then the career changer, which I'd say it's like the biggest chunk of people are this kind of profile. And it's just people that want to change careers and start a job and get a job, their first job as developers. So we've had here people that, well, Kat was a consultant, strategy consultant. We've had flight attendants. We've had musicians. We've had gardeners. So, we've seen like many, many different cases. And the thing that we require is just that you're really passionate about coding and about technology, and that you're able to learn fast, basically. But I'd say motivation is the number one thing that we look for in a student. So this is some of the companies. I don't know if you recognize them or not, but they're really cool, most of them. I'd say all of them. They're all Spanish. They're all based either Madrid, Barcelona, and then you have a couple in southern Spain as well. And that's it. Thank you very much. You have my email here if you need anything, and I'll let you with the projects and with the main people here that are the students. Thank you.
Now we're gonna go to the best part for me. That is the personal presentations. Now, give a huge welcome to the man. After founding a successful startup in Colombia called Martinica, that I really recommend you to follow on Facebook, they are custom motorbikes, he came all the way through Ironhack. All the way from Colombia, welcome, Juan.
Hello. Gracias. Hello. It works? Yeah. Okay. And when it's on. It's working. Okay. I don't have the remote control.
So. Yeah, but don't worry. Do you need it?
Yeah. But never mind. I would just come back and. Thank you. Well, you saw half of my presentation already. Well, I'm going to talk about my project. It's called Mentorants. It's a simple, very simple way to communicate between people. So simple that actually anyone can get in right now. You just like log in, you put your name in, and you start talking. That's it. I'm going to talk a little bit about the technologies I used. Express is the base of the application, super simple, is the thing I wanted to do, as I wanted to keep on learning JavaScript, and I fell in love with JavaScript, thanks to one of our professors, it's called Pinchito. Some of you may know him. And Express is the base, well, not the base, but the simplest way to build an app, a simple, fast app on JavaScript using Node.js. That is the second technology, well, is the base for Express. Then I use Socket.io in order to connect with another user, in order to get real-time communication with people, for it to be simple. You can see when someone's typing down, when someone is logging out, logging in. So you're going to be connected the entire time without needing any call to the database or anything. The third technology, it's WebRTC, and it's the technology that allowed me to connect people through video calls just by calling them by their names on the app. I will show you later. Then jQuery, in order to make simple animations for the app, so anyone can just look at how it goes in and out when you log in, when you get out of the application, everything is like fluid as a single experience. You have Bootstrap. I use it in order to get some responsiveness from the project, in order to organize all the presentation of the login page and the chat. I use GitHub, of course. Everyone uses it to upload your code into a safe place and you create your repository. And Heroku is the last tool I use in order to deploy my application. Now it's been deployed, and you can just log in to mentrance.com. And I will just show you how it works right now. You go to mentrance.com. It's still in beta. So you just put your name in. Oops, put the wrong name though. Anyway, so you can see it has no buttons, it has nothing. It just type, enter to send, call, quit, to exit, and user.show to display the connected users. So if I call users.show, it will print me a list of the people that are connected right now to my chat. I just type, hello. Oh, it's someone connected like that. So there is Javi, hey, hello, Paco is typing. Hola is saying, hey, cool presentation, thank you. Kibura, whoa, how many people are connected right now? Let's see, show, wow. Well, now let's try something else. I will just come back. Everyone is seeing what is happening right now. Everyone can see that I'm logging out, logging in, just back. And I'm going to try to call my mentor, Javi. I just call it by saying javi.call. I allow my camera. And he has to accept the connection. Hey, Javi. So he's right there trying the application out. If you press escape, you can go back to the chat, but you're going to be still connected. And there is a hint from mentorance. Call video is always a dollar. It's like jQuery. And it goes back to the video. So like that, you can just type everything in your computer. Thank you, Javi. And you don't need to raise your hands. You don't have any button to press. It's just super fast, simple. And if you want to go out of the video, you just call. You call the call. And then end. And I'm disconnecting from the user right now. That's it. That's very simple. I'm working on it. Do you have any questions? Oops.
I have here the microphone if you have any questions. Come on, guys.
One question. Let's make it simpler. One question. There is a question on the back.
Hello. You store the conversation or anything in database or no?
No, I don't have any database for the time being. I don't have anything to store, any conversations, any users. Just simple chat. You log in, you log out. Every time you log out, everything is erased. You cannot see what happened before. You cannot see who's left or connected. Just real time.
And the login, when you save the username or?
I was working on that. I'm going to just use the locked storage. So in a way, when you log in with your name, it will remember it. So we just tell you, welcome back, your name, and then log into the chat space.
Okay.
That was just one question.
We have another question.
Well, congratulations for the project. My question, I mean, you use a lot of different technologies. So first question is, it was easy to put together all the technologies. And the second one is, which was the most complicated thing?
Well, it was Node, Express. I started from zero. So I had a week to learn everything, how to create the app. Socket IO was very simple to understand. But after that, the connection with the WebRTC was a little bit confusing, so it took me a while for that. That's why, for the time being, I only have video and real-time chatting. I would like to take it to the next level in screen sharing, maybe room places for companies. So any company that has a fast chat, They will just like log in with their account into the rooms, and they will have real-time communication between the space they have in the company.
Any more questions? Okay, let's give a huge applause to Juan.
Thank you.
Oh, yes.
Well, after finishing her master's degree in Cambridge this year, all the way from Hong Kong, welcome, Wendy.
Hello. Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Wendy. And my project is called Startup Co-Mentorship Network. And just now, I'm introduced as Cambridge graduate, and I study philosophy in media and culture, and I also study theater, film, sociology, and literature before. And I had no technical background and no programming experience before Ironhack, so these 2 months is a very new experience for me, and I've learned a lot, here in Madrid. And my app's idea is very basic. If you have used anything like language exchange network, then you will know. For example, I know Chinese and you know Spanish, and you want to study Chinese and I want to study Spanish, then we are a good match. It's just as easy as that, but it's for startup founders and workers. These days, there are lots of startup founders, they are desperate for getting mentors because they really want guidance. For example, some startup founders, they are very good at coding, programming, but they have no idea what is marketing or business. And some business people, they really want to learn more about coding. So I think they're a good match. So I got this idea that a startup exchange, skills exchange network is really a personal network that you can have a non-hierarchical platform for people to just meet up and they can talk about their ideas and their experience. It's very accessible, it's one-to-one, it's very fast to easy to use my app to get the people that you want to meet, and also it's totally for free. So it's not like those startup incubators or accelerator that you have to pay a lot of money and it's really selective. So what the skills that I'm talking about, I have figured out that these are the 16 skills that I think are very essential for all the startup founders to know. So from entrepreneurship to people management to money and to the technology, that a lot of people that are desperate to know more about them and they have no way to learn. So here comes to my very simple app. So, before going to this app, you have a very simple sign-up form that you put your name, your companies, your city, and a list of skills that you want to learn. You can choose multiple skills. And, this is the skills that you're good at, sorry. And this is the list of the skills that you want to learn more about. And after creating a profile, the app will bring you to this page, and this page here is a list of users matching your skill set. So these are the people who has the skills that you want to learn, or these are the people that want some skills from you. So you can see, look at their profile. Okay, Donald, web developer, and hack. And you can click on their profile, and this is the bootstrap model. See, you can see the details of Donald, that you can see that, oh, he's in Madrid, and his expertise is this, and the skills that he wants to learn is this, and this is his description. And also, at the sign-up form, you have to provide your Twitter's account or your company's Twitter's account so that other users can take a look and see what you're up to. So here is the Twitter's timeline. And here, the second part is, this is the events happening in Madrid that relating to all these keywords that you have just put in your the skills that you need to learn. So you want to learn more about finance, accounting, and in Madrid, these are the events. And this is actually Eventbrite's API. So after clicking on like one of the events that you like, it brings you to the events page. Then you can look and see if you want it. And this is the Eventbrite's API page that is quite easy to use, but it's also quite time consuming to figure out how they manipulate the data. Also, one of the key things is you want to contact these people. So on this profile, oh, you really like this guy and you think you learn a lot from him, then you click send message. And here is like those Gmail chat bots that you can use. And here's your little image of you. So it's like the chat bots in Facebook or Gmail. So just now, I've used the Twitter's timeline. So you can easily get the Twitter's timeline. Like even like for you, you can go to Twitter's page and you can create your own timeline and you can put it on your website or wherever. So a little bit of code. This is the main controller I have, users controller. That here you can see the Eventbrite API here. And also, one key thing for my app is to filter out the users that you fit into your profile. So these are the filters that you pick the users who fit into your profile, that they have something that you want to learn from. And this is a bit of code for that carousel that you have just seen. So here is like you can see the images like a carousel or slide. And also here's the model. So one challenge for my project is I've spent a lot of time in thinking about how to construct the database. So for the users, these are the list of the parameters that you will give. And also for the messages, I construct it into this model conversation. And one conversation has a lot of messages. Then each message has the user sender ID and the recipient ID. So one very important thing I learned from Ironhack is always search for the gems that can help you from the library of Ruby on Rails. So these are some of the gems that I have used. For example, this Eventbrite gem make it very easy for me to get access to the Eventbrite events. And that's it for my presentation. Thank you.
Does someone have any questions? Come on, guys. Any hands? Well, let's give another huge applause to Wendy. Great job. Now, after finishing his degree in economics, he decided to change his career. And now we can say he made it all the way from Valencia. Welcome, Jesus.
Excellent. So, hi everyone. This is my project, it's called Music Safe. My name is Jesus. I have a degree in economics, like Alvaro just said. And I love music, and now coding as well, after doing Ironhack. So, the project allows you to save music from YouTube on this application, and you can tag it, and it has, in my opinion, in general, a better user experience for music listening than YouTube does. So these are the technologies I use for the project. They are all stuff that we learn in Ironhack. The first three are for the front end of the application, so that means the visual side of it, and they help me make it responsive and have animations going in and out and not having to reload the page so much, so it feels like it's a native application. Bootstrap helps with that as well. It helps me with making it look much better. The YouTube API helps me get videos from YouTube. And of course, Rails, Ruby on Rails, takes care of the backend. All right, this is how the application looks like. Once you are inside the user area of it, you have the songs that you have added in. You can search YouTube, add tags, and show playlists. If you click the video or you click any of the little play buttons, it will play the video. So if you search on YouTube, you will get a new window where you can add the tracks. And then you can also add tags to it. For example, original soundtrack or funny or whatever to the music that you're saving. Then later you can search through your music with the tags. You can search for music that have a specific style or that exclude a specific style. But the most important thing for me, and I think the most interesting part, is that you can not only search from inside the app, but if you are in YouTube, as I am a lot, and you have arrived there somehow by clicking some Facebook link, and you now want to save this, I actually created a pop-up, a Chrome extension that you can use. You click on it, and it will show you the title of that you're trying to save. You can add tags there as well, and when you save it, it will appear in your application. So the thing is, I'm not trying for people to be constrained inside the application to find their music, because in my own music discovery, I search everywhere. I use YouTube mostly, then SoundCloud as well, and other services, which I will integrate in the future into the application, so you can have more than one service integrated. And I oftentimes end up in a YouTube video that I would like to save. And of course, I can favorite it, and it will save it to my account, but it sometimes gets deleted, because YouTube videos get deleted. So then, when it gets deleted, you no longer know what was there, which irks me a lot. And also, YouTube doesn't have tags, which is also something that I like. So, before I'm here, let me go. I'm sorry. Let me go here, which is the code for the extension. This is, I think, the only little tricky part that I did. I had to look through the Google documentation to find out how to do an extension, which turns out to be really simple. It's like an HTML page. The pop-up thing is like an HTML page, and it has two JavaScript files. One of them is for the pop-up, and the other one gets into YouTube. So when you call the extension, this is what the arrows represent, actually. When you call the extension, it calls the content script, which is inside YouTube, and that returns the name of the song that you're trying to save. And then the extension bundles that up with the URL of the video, so you can access it later. and then it does a post, which means it sends it to the actual application, so you can have it on your profile. Yeah, and for technically demanded types, it's all authenticated with device, the device gem. And then once you have saved it, you can actually just play it from here, just clicking play, or clicking on the actual thing. So if you want to see it live and not just in a slideshow, it's here. See? I can add tags to it. Can I say this is jazz? Or rock. Or rock, I already have it, so it doesn't add it anymore. And you can search for it here. Yeah, that's essentially what my application is about. Thank you.
Great job, thanks, Jesus. Any questions?
Well, thank you, Jesus, for your presentation. Mm-hmm. I would like to know if your application can recognize what kind of content. I mean, it recognizes music, mm-hmm. Or maybe you can apply it to recognize speech from a lecture from somewhere else. Have you thought about it?
What do you mean by recognize?
I mean, maybe you entry search quote, and then your application may say, well, this is music, but maybe it doesn't.
Yeah.
So do you think about the possibility of recognizing music in your application?
Oh.
Or there could be some mistakes when searching for content?
Sure.
Searching for contents?
Sure, that would be interesting. Right now, what it does is it only gets videos in the category of music, because I have set it up that way. You can do that with the YouTube API. But yeah, you could certainly use it for any type of videos that you want to save. Right now, the responsibility of choosing the right video is on the user. Yeah.
But it could be possible to extend this functionality.
Sure, you could use it for anything. It's just focused on music, because I say it's focused on music, but really, you can pull any videos from it.
Very interesting. Okay, thank you.
My question was regarding, you said that if the video is removed from YouTube, mm-hmm. then what happens in your app?
Okay, good question. Then you still get, it won't work. Like if, say, this video was removed and you try to play it, it would show video not present or something like that. But you still have the artist and the title, which is the crucial information. You know, you could search for it again. You can edit it manually. You can edit the track. So you can just search for it again. Right now, you just search for it again. In the future, I would like to add, like for it to make it automatically, so if it recognizes that the video is no longer there, it will do a search and just maybe grab the first video if it's something like that.
So how would it be different from making multiple playlists in YouTube itself, like in your account when you can make multiple playlists?
Well, there's two main differences. First is the tags, which are not yet implemented in YouTube, and also that right now it just works for YouTube, but ideally, and I started doing this, but for now it's just implemented on YouTube. Ideally, you will also integrate SoundCloud and any other music services that you use.
Thank you.
Any more questions? Okay, yeah?
Thank you. So I wanted to ask, do you actually create a playlist, like a sequence of music that is going to be played in the future, or is it a repository that what you're creating?
Right now, it's just a repository. You can actually create playlists, or that's on the short list of that I want features that I want to add in the future after I finish making the tagging system complete. But yeah, it would be better if you could just do playlists and have it play automatically once a video finishes. Yeah, I mean, that's where it's going, yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Okay. Let's give a huge applause to Jesus. Now we have a story that I really like. It's about a family. Okay. I'm proud to say that they are Spanish, but they have lived the past 8 years in Singapore. I would like to welcome the Morenos family. Yeah. Well, sorry, I forgot to say.
It's not the whole family.
I forgot to say that I really like this story because the father is a professional investor and the son is going to be a great professional. So he's about to start university and you'll need to follow him in the future.
Okay.
Come on, guys.
Okay, so our project is called Hitbook. Well, the first slide is about Manuel and I. We have no technical background, so everything that we learn about coding, we learn at Ironhack, so you can blame them if it doesn't go well. I'm a former investment banker and entrepreneur and investor, and I have a bunch of degrees that Manuel didn't want to show because he says I'm a show-off. And he has the advantage of the age. He's just 19, and he's going to university in September. He went to an international school in Singapore. So
basically, I'm the version 2.0 of what my dad is right now.
Okay. Okay, so Hitbook is the name of our project. Why Hitbook? And maybe Manuel, you can explain.
Well, I finished high school last September in Singapore. And when I was looking for universities, one of the main problems was, as an international student, was finding a university that went accordingly to my grade. So looking through all the universities' websites, I wasted a lot of time because you have to go to the university, you need to look for the course, you need to look for the exact grade. It's a pain, and you waste so much time. So, well, we looked for it together, and we came up with the idea of making a website where you could actually find the grade and make it easier for international students that nowadays is a very normal.
Yeah, so we look into what is out there to help students to find universities, to get advice on what universities to attend. There are two very successful websites, one in the US called College Confidential and the other in the UK, the Student Room. Both focus on local students. So we thought, okay, let's do the same, but with international students that are actually looking to study in the UK, in the US, in Spain, wherever around the world, and give them a tool for university and academic advice. So we would start with the international students that do the IB program, which is the degree that Manuel did and we know well, and then we can move to the A levels, which is a UK-based type of degree that is studied a lot in other international schools. So technical challenges.
One of the main ones was the pair coding. I don't think Ironhack has ever had two people doing one project. So for the technological side was the whole concept of uploading it to GitHub. You have a lot of conflicts and you need to fix that, and you spend quite a big amount of time trying to fix those conflicts.
So basically working with me.
Yeah, also that the conflicts, because it's father and son, there's no embarrassment. There's, if your idea is bad, your idea is bad. You're gonna know. Then for the website,
yes, we also did a few gem integration. It's built in Ruby and Rails, and we integrated a few gems. Some of them are very useful. Some others, then they become a black box, and you lose flexibility. So we learned to work with somebody else's code, but sometimes it was very painful for a project that is only 2 weeks.
One of the other challenges was personalizing the website because each student is different. So we try and make it so that each user could choose their own subjects or their own courses and save it. We'll show you this later. And we did this through Ajax, so you could get a very smooth clear of the page to show the results. And we've used the Ajax to connect the front end and the back end. And to be honest, at first it was terrible. It was very difficult. But once you get the hang of it, it was brilliant.
So the other challenge was to build a nice front end and design. We thought it was going to be easy, but then we dedicated a lot of time to it. We use Bootstrap, but we tried to make it a little bit personalized to what we like. So we're going to go into the website, which is what we call a global hub for high school students. There are three main sections. If you want to scroll down, one is the forum where the users can discuss the subjects, ask questions about the subjects they have in high school, also about the colleges they want to study. Then the university search, and we will go into that later, and then future discussions. So if we go to future discussions, it's just basically a blog. It's for our editorial content. We know people that are at universities, at top universities, so we're going to ask them to provide with blogs on how they got into those universities. So if we log in, this would be the admin. In this case, you have the edit, you can edit the post, and you can work with it. So the other section of community building is the forums. Here we integrated a gem that is called Forum, that is an engine that allows you to build a forum utility, the classical forum utility. What we did that is a little bit special is that you can personalize the forums menu on your left, choosing the subjects that you are doing. So you have now in the sidebar, you can go directly to the forum page, and in the future, if you have more content related to those subjects, it will show here. And then we have the university search. Manuel, you want to?
So this is what I was talking about earlier, the difficulty of finding the right course for you because you don't always get all the information and all the courses you could consider. So this is the search that basically for now we're considering including universities from the US, UK, and Canada. And for the international bachelor, the point system goes from 0 to 45. So for example, if you think you're gonna get in between 30 and 40 points, you hit search, you insert your points, you hit search, and you get the universities with the courses that apply to what you've inserted. And these are test universities and courses. They are real, but they're just for showing purposes. So for example, if I further fill in the search, now it's only the UK universities. If I put business, I get the ones with business. And then if I put in the university, I also get the more specific. The other functionality is that you can go and find more courses within the university. And you have your IB points and the A levels, which is what they teach in England. And then you can hit on the course and get more information regarding the course, the extra requirements for the IB, the extra requirements for the A level, and so on. And regarding making it for each student, same as what you can add the subjects that you take, you can also save the courses that you like. And obviously, if you try to save it again, the machine will tell you, oh, no, you can't. You already have this saved. Next, in your profile, you can see you have your subjects saved. You have your courses saved. And they're all quick links, so if you want to view it again. And once you save the courses and you've seen them all, you can compare them so that you can have course from the US, a course from the UK, a course from Canada, anything. And this makes it easier for an international student that's considering many countries to compare things. And in the profile, you also have the standard edit your username, your password, your email, choose your picture, and so on.
So that's basically it. The website has like two clear areas. One is community building through the forums and the discussions, and the other is information about university. The next step for us is to build a database of universities, so the search is real and is helpful for international students. So that's basically our project as Hitbook.
Any questions? Yeah, there is a hand.
Hi, very nice presentation.
Thank you.
And one question is, how you maintain all the database updated with all the courses around the universities? I mean, not only US or Canada. You say that you want it around the world, so how do you make this possible?
Well, we, as I said, our next step is to have a fully database working that we don't right now. In some countries, you have public entities that keep information about the universities, the degrees, and the requirements. And in many of them, that information is legally available because it's public information, so we can take it from the website without requiring a permit from them. And because of the information is not time sensitive, we can do it once every month or something like that. So we also know what countries international students usually apply for, so we don't pretend to cover 100%, obviously. With probably 10 countries, we can cover 95% of the universities that international students apply to.
Thank you.
My question is a little bit personal. How did you found Ironhackers from Singapore? And also, which university are you going to choose after having this tool in your power? And why, you know? And how will you relate it to your startup?
Well, how we found Ironhack, because in Singapore, it's a little bit different. You start university in January, you finished in September. So
in December.
November, December, sorry. So I had there 7 months where I didn't know what to do until I started university, and I didn't just want to waste those months. And we've always juggled around with the idea of learning how to program, because nowadays it's so essential. So actually my father found the course. He said, look at this course, check it out. It's very interesting. People seem to learn a lot from it. So I signed up. And then 2 months later, he comes up to me and he's like, you know, I've always wanted to code. I'm joining with you.
I didn't tell him before, otherwise.
That conversation was in Singapore, yeah?
Yeah.
So the university?
University.
You need to answer if you don't want.
What do you mean with...
Continue your career.
Well, funnily enough, I'm studying at IE here in Spain. After considering universities in the US and in the UK, I've decided to come back home and just study here.
Thank you very much.
The project is great, and that's all.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We have the right audience.
Okay, I think that's it now. Oh, no. Finished now?
Are there any other questions? No, well, give a huge applause to the Morenos family. Now we have a project that, as Iron Hackers, we have really liked. Well, This is a story that I also like a lot. It's about a student, a graphic designer, that really wants to start to learn to code. And he made this. I think we're going to start using it to rate your iron hackership. You will now see it. Now, I would like to welcome all the way from Pontevedra to Elias.
Hi, thank you everyone. Good evening, and let's start. Well, here we have some personal data, maybe. Okay, that's all. If you want to follow me on Twitter, I just opened an account today. So I would like to have some followers. Well, technologies. I use many technologies. These are all of them. I also classify them by how much I like them or how much I use them. But before I use them, what I wanted to do was to learn them. So this is why I joined Ironhack. And my idea came from this situation. It is called the Iron Pack. But what is an Iron Pack? Let's join the application and we will see it. Okay. Well, I'm sorry because this application is just for iron hackers, because what I wanted to try is to test your iron hacker skills. I wanted to build an application that tests how much iron hacker you are. So next week I programmed a bot, a mailer, and the iron hackers will receive a link where they can join the application and test them skills. This is an example, this will be mine. A bit slow today. Okay. I'm sorry. Well, here we are. This is our personal customized Iron Pack. This is our first screen. Here we have some information about it, what is it about, and what is the Iron Pack about? Iron Pack is a game. Actually, there are three games that we have to play to test how much Iron Hackers we are. Let's see. I'm sorry, it's too lazy today. Well, we have here our first game. It's a 404 amazing shooter. This is just a classic shooter that I built. And we have to fight again our invaders that are 404 arrows. I think everyone knows them. And we have to let the 20 and 202 invaders let our country or our screen. So let's play and see how it works. I have a nice starred background, and what happens if I kill a 202 status? I lose a life. Again, I have another one. Yeah, I'm going to suicidize myself because we don't have enough time to play it. But the most you play, the most difficult it gets. So it's cool to, in 2 minutes, we will see a bunch of 404 errors coming. But we don't have time enough to see it all, so I'm just going to lose a life touching this error and killing this. Okay, game over. I'm sorry. Well, here we are. We are saving our punctuation and waiting to localhost, and we will join the next screen, which is the Pinchitos challenge. What is it about? Pinchito was one of our professors that teaches us a lot of JavaScript and Node.js, and we had a lot of fun, actually. So I built this game. which is about fighting against him in a writing code challenge. Here we have the instructions. In every game, we have the same structure. First, we have some info with instructions that we have to follow, and then we play it. So what is it about? Pinchito is going to write on Vim, on the text editor Vim, and we are going to use Sublime. I'm going, yeah, he's saying some random stuff. But we cannot cheat. If I want to cheat, I cannot copy this line, so I'm going to try to write it. If I write it in the proper way that I think so, it will turn in the color of Sublime, which is our text editor. It's OK. Let's try the next one, if I have enough time. Yeah, it is working, but Pinchito beat us. And what's happening now? So, yeah. OK, so after these two games, we show that we are Iron Hacker enough to get the Iron Pack, which is the last step of my application. What is the Iron Pack? Well, as I said, what I wanted to do with this project was to learn a lot. And our Iron Pack will provide us a bunch of links related to web development, a lot of tutorials, websites with info about events or wherever, new technologies. And they are all provided by our mentors and our professors. Now what we pass our Iron Pack, we can play a game again to every game. For example, this one, which is a bonus track that is about clicking on a rainbow square. Because when Lucas Cepeda showed us how to build this effect on CSS, everyone loved it. So yeah, it's cool as a warm-up, or if you want to have some fun and don't think after coding, it's great. And what happens if I fail? You have to begin again. But anyway, because I showed that I'm Iron Hacker enough, so I can go directly to my congratulations website. And another really cool thing that I think is going to make my application usable is this stuff here, which are rankings. I did it really well, so I'm in the second one in the global ranking, but we can also compare them here through games. So I'm the first one on the first game because I skipped it. And yeah, they are the top five of my application. So that was all. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Any questions? No? Okay. Thanks, Elias.
Thank you.
Now this is what we're going to do. All of you here have received an email, okay? An email, we've sent you a type form and we want you to vote. Who do you think has the best project, okay? So you're gonna be the ones that decide who of these guys got the best project, okay? So we're gonna leave you 5 minutes, we're gonna turn on some amazing music that Alberto chose, and we're gonna leave you 5 minutes to vote. Then we have like the final decision. And after that, we will go to drink some mojitos. So let's go. Begin voting, please.
You gotta know, I'm feeling love, made it gold. I never loved another one, another you. It's gotta be love, I said it. You gotta know, I'm feeling love. You gotta know, I'm feeling love. You gotta know, I'm feeling love. Made it gold, I'll never love her. Another one, another you. It's gotta be love, I said it.
I might as well be in our garden. I said I smell in the air is a dripping rose. So to be my warden of anything there that's made of gold. A physical kiss is nothing without it. And you close your eyes to see what it's done. The body that lies is built up on love. The hair, it can make you old. Another hole to dig my soul in. I'll leave anything bare that keeps me sold. A physical kiss is nothing without it. And you close your eyes. What it's done. The body that lies is built up on looking. Is all that remains before it's begun.
You gotta know, I'm feeling love. Made it gold, I'll never love her. Another one, another you. It's gotta be.
Well, I'm proud to announce that with more than 30% of the votes, the winner of this hack show is Juan.
Come on, Juan.
Do you want to share some words with all of us?
Well, I hope in the future you will use the application. It's made for you, so for everyone who wants to use it. Thank you again.
And now, guys, thanks for coming. Thanks to all of you. And now let's go and have some free mojitos.
Oh, so you're weaker, I am. You doubt I'll bother reading into it. I probably won't. Left to my own devices, but that's the difference in our opinions. You're a mouthful, that a mouthful. Another week on my own. Now I'm a novel, made resourceful. I start a chain with my thought. Talk is cheap, my darling. When you're feeling right at home, I wanna make you move with confidence. I wanna be with you alone. So help me help you start it. You're too comfortable to know. Throwing out those words, no, you gotta feel it on your own. Sustain it, that's what I'm thinking, not what I'm drinking. I hold up my ways, your thoughts are pervasive. It's not a statement, but peace can be evasive. You're a mouthful, glad a mouthful. Another week on my own. Now I'm a novel, made resourceful. I start a chain with my thought. Talk is cheap, my darling.
Feeling all